Thank you for tuning in to this week's episode of Set Your Day in Order with Bishop Howard V. Willis, Jr. Chapter 24 and verse 36. I'm going to read to you this morning from the New King James translation of the Bible, where the word of God simply reads this way. But of that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, but my Father only. But as the days of Noah were, so also will the coming of the Son of Man. For as in the days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day that Noah entered the ark, did not know until the flood came and took them all away. So also will the coming of the Son of Man be. Then two men will be in the field. One will be taken and the other left. Two women will be grinding at the mill. One will be taken and the other left. Watch, therefore, for you do not know what hour your Lord is coming. So word of God for the people of God. Glory be to our God. For the moments of time that we do have together, I want to talk to you from a subject entitled, The Coming of the Lord. Coming of the Lord. As you know, this is in fact what the fifth installment of the series Preparing for the Lord. Let us pray. Oh, holy and all-wise God, it is in the mighty and matchless name of Jesus the Christ where I yet yield to myself on this day, asking God that you would speak to me and through me, that you would renew my mind even in the midst of preaching. For Lord, I understand one thing about preaching. Preaching cannot occur unless the Holy Spirit allows. Holy Spirit, we give you permission to come down in this place and through this virtual worship. Come now that we might in fact be changed. That the weak will in fact say, I'm strong. That the sick might say, I'm well. That the lost might say, what must I do to receive salvation? And all that shall be done, God. All that shall be received. We'll be careful, God, to give your name the glory, the praise, and the honor. For it's in Jesus' name that we do pray. Amen. So I want to talk to you today from the subject entitled, The Coming of the Lord. This morning I want to tell you a story about a farmer. This farmer noticed every autumn, a tragedy that played out in his cornfields. You see, all summer long, he found families of field mice. These field mice had made their homes among his growing plants. While they made their homes in his plants, they fed themselves and they slept. They worked and played. And they raised their families. The mice imagined that those green fields belonged to them. But then one day, at the end of the summer, the mouse community would get an awful shock. You see, the farmer was would enter his fields in the autumn. And he would take his harvesting machinery to bring forth the harvest for that year. And all of a sudden, those comfortable summer homes that the mice had established, those food pantries that were so filled with food, the things that they had enjoyed running through during their summer, Reverend Ray, all of a sudden came crashing down on their heads. You see, the moral of the story is simple. Like the mice, we are enjoying the luxuries of this world with no thought that one day all that we see will one day come to an end.
Yes, sir.
We look upon this world as our home. And so day after day, we go off to work. We earn as much money as we can. We enjoy the sights and sounds of this massive landscape called Earth. We fall in love. We get married. We play. We have children. And imagining all the while, we think to ourselves that this world is our home and we'll always be at home. Yet like the field mice in this cornfield, we tend to forget that this world is not ours. That this world in which we see, in which we are able to travel, is just a temporary place.
That's right.
That the day of harvest is on its way. And so, Sister Karen, on this third Sunday of Advent, a day in which we focus on the joy of the coming of the Lord, I would like to continue to remind us that this preparation for the Lord's return should be filled with a joy of expectation. That our lives as we travel through this world should be lives that anticipate further joy of being with our Lord. While others may look at this day as a day of dread and fear, the child of God waits on the coming of the Lord. We wait for the coming of the Lord with a heart filled with joy because we know that as Matthew 16 and 27 would declare, the Son of Man will come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then he will reward each according to his works. For we know as children of God, the coming of the Lord, it represents a day of deliverance. It represents a day of salvation from this present world of oppression, this world of sickness, and this world filled with all of its evil devices. You see, for the child of God, it will be a day filled with joy and satisfaction. For I hear John say, beloved, now we are the children of God. And it has not yet been revealed what we shall be. But we know that when he is revealed, we shall be like him. For we shall see him as he is. So in order to meet this day filled with joy, in order to meet this day of the coming of the Lord with satisfaction, we have to prepare ourselves. This is all I've been trying to do in the midst of this series. I've been trying to help us to understand this world is not your home. That while you are here, you are to in fact prepare for another world. And this is what Jesus does in our text this morning. Here he is on the Mount of Olives as he spoke to his disciples concerning their questions in Matthew 24 and 3. Where the disciples simply said, tell us when these things will be. What will be the sign of your coming and the end of the age? You see, my beloved brothers and sisters, we must understand that in the mind of the disciples, when Jesus talks about his coming, or better yet, his return, what they thought in their minds, Deacon Moe, was that that Jesus was going to set up his earthly kingdom. That he was going to establish his earthly kingdom in royalty and splendor. That he, in fact, would establish a kingdom that would surpass this existing temple in which they had their eyes on. This earthly kingdom was to be in the fashion of what they would consider that King David had done. That how King David had consolidated the country. Because they were under Roman oppression, they thought that this was the time in which Jesus would recall those days of King David and establish that kingdom. And so it is in the disciples' minds. They imagined Jesus was going to overthrow that Roman government and be established as their king in a messianic reign. However, Jesus responded to the disciples with a warning. He didn't just give them an answer. He gave them something they had to heed to. Mm-hmm. Something they had to watch out for. Yeah. Something they would have to prepare for. Mm-hmm. Thus, after he tells them about false Christ, you can read Matthew 24 in your leisure. Mm-hmm. As he talks about false Christ that shall come. Mm-hmm. After he speaks to them concerning signs which are the beginning. Did you hear what I said? He talks about signs that are the beginning of sorrow. And after he speaks to them about a period of great tribulation, he lets them know how they should prepare themselves for this great day of the coming of the Lord. However, the caveat to all of this is that the question of when is never given definitively. Jesus lets the disciples know who does know when these things will be. For verse 36, he simply declares, but at that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, but my Father only. Well, my beloved brothers and sisters, as I get straight to my text this morning, the first thing I want us to glean from the text about the coming of the Lord is that the coming of the Lord, Sister Stephanie, is secret. You see, every generation since the time of Jesus has been confronted with the reality of signs pointing to the end. And the Son of Man could have come to any of those generations, including our present generation. But the actual time of the parousia, or the second coming of our Lord, and the end of this day or this age, is only known to God. So, Sister Bernadette, the coming of the Lord is secret. I want to press this particular point because we must understand we are not made to know everything. I know our nature is to want to know when and want to know how and why. And somebody's listening to me this morning and you want to know where and you want to know when this is going to be. But I've come to tell you, as children of God, we must understand God does not tell us everything. Think about it. Jesus, who is deeply and interconnected with the will of the Father. Jesus, who is God in the flesh, teaches us that God does not reveal everything. Jesus lets us know that they are just something that God keeps to himself. And Jesus, who is fully divine, who is fully human, gives us a perfect example that in his role as the Son, he stays committed to the will of the Father. And he continues his mission on earth. Sister Jennifer, I'm going to make this point a little bit clear. See, while you're trying to figure out, while you're trying to determine why, when you want to know when, God is simply saying to you, my beloved, just do my will. If you knew everything, then there would be no need for one to walk by faith. See, Jesus shows us how certain things are not important, but the mission of God is. That we must, in fact, stay focused on what the Lord has called us to do. That we must, in fact, stay focused on what the Lord has commanded us to do. And the reality is, oftentimes, blessings, my beloved, they're withheld. Blessings are withheld from us because we are not willing to let go of our inquisitive mind. Well, I'm helping somebody today.
Amen.
See, for whatever reason, God decides to withhold or keep hidden or keep secret his purpose for doing a thing. You see, Ebony, our obligation to the Lord is simply to be obedient. We are called to do what the Lord has told us to do and leave the end result under God. I know somebody doesn't like this, Jackie. I know somebody here wants me to say that God's going to tell you everything and that God's going to reveal to you. I know you want me to give you that reasoning and that type of gospel. Why everything that you're going through, why it might be tragic, why it might be trying. I know you want me to say that God is going to tell you why, but I come by to tell you God might not tell. I'm reminded of my homiletic professor, the late, great Miles Jerome Jones. He says one of the biggest challenges of life is, can you live with a question? I want to know today, can you trust God even when God doesn't give you the answer? Can you trust God when there's no way that he seems to be making right now? Can you trust God that he's going to bring you through? Can you trust God when God won't tell you why? Can you live with a question? This is why the psalmist in Psalms 135 in verse 6, he says, whatever the Lord pleases, he does. In heaven and in earth, in the seas and in all deep places. In other words, what the psalmist is teaching us is the Lord's prerogative to do as he pleases. Our duty is to remain faithful to his word. See, the faith of our forefathers, it taught us this, Reverend DeLores. See, that there are just some things that God would keep secret, and one day we will understand it by and by. However, if we are living in this postmodern era, this Google, this fast-paced area, we're living in a generation that just wants to know why. We're living in a time, Sister Devetta, where folk just don't want to trust the process. We just simply want to Google it. And we believe we have a right to know, and we want God to tell us right now, and we won't do it unless God tells us. However, as the faithful of God, we must understand that God has a purpose in the end, that God may reveal or he may choose not to reveal it. This is why the old church would sing that song that I love to hear. They would simply say, further along, we'll know more about it. Further along, we'll understand why. Cheer up, my brother. Live in the sunshine. See, we'll all understand it by and by. But I tell you, I love the stanza that says, tempted and tried. How often we question why we must suffer year after year being accused by those of our loved ones, even though we walk in God's holy fear. So I come by to tell somebody, further along, we'll know more about it. Further along, we'll understand why. For the coming of the Lord is secret. However, the coming of the Lord is not only secret, the coming of the Lord will be sudden. So Jesus then says, are y'all walking with me today? But as the days of Noah were, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. He talks to the disciples about Noah. He talks to the disciples about how the flood was sudden in Noah's day. And just like it was sudden in Noah's day, his return will be sudden in ours. The Lord's coming, while expected, it will be unexpected. It will be a surprise. As he says in verse 44, therefore you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. Jesus continues to teach us in this Olivet discourse. Though they had watched Noah build this tremendous ark, though they may have saw Noah gathering all of the material, though they heard Noah preach righteousness for many years, they paid him no mind. And I simply want to remind the church, I want to remind some evangelists today, in all your endeavors, don't you dare be discouraged in proclaiming and sharing the gospel. Or just be faithful and know that, like in the days of Noah, there are going to be many who will ignore the clarion call to get their house in order. There's going to be many who are going to fail to even, let me say this way, there are going to be many who hear this message and still fail to prepare for the coming of the Lord. Jesus gives the disciples an example of how the world was destroyed before and the works of Noah. He uses a part of Hebrew history which all the Hebrew children and the disciples of the Lord would be familiar with. He lets us know they were eating and they were drinking. They were marrying and they were giving in marriage. While all the while they should have been repenting and praying. They were in defiance of all of the warnings that came from the words and the physical display illustrated by Noah's ark. What should have awakened them really caused them to go to sleep. What awakened them, they discounted as foolishness. Despite even seeing the sign of this massive ark, they kept doing what they wanted to do. You see, the people of Noah's day were secure in what they had all around them. They were too busy trying to make everything or make the nation great again. They were too busy trying to make money, and they were not concerned about maintaining health care. They were too concerned about how to live in this day, and they weren't worried about a pandemic. They were too busy Snapchatting and posting their videos on TikTok that they were in fact careless as it related to the care of their soul. They're trying to find out what's the next challenge in which they can participate as opposed to challenging their soul. Now, you know what I'm talking about. I ain't here trying to buy the eye. I'm trying to get your soul right for the Lord. You got to prepare yourself trying to look at all of these things that are just bad. They'll be here today and they'll be gone tomorrow. See, they were blinded to the signs of the destruction that was on its way. Their preoccupation was with the world, and they were satisfied with every carnal desire and pleasure they sought to fulfill. Thus, Noah's words was foolishness to them. But as we look at this text in depth, the word eating in verse 38 in the Greek, it implies the idea of gnawing food greedily. It implies that it's one who eats food greedily like an animal. The word would indicate to Jesus' disciples that the people of Noah's day, they were gluttons. They had learned to eat and drink too much. They went overboard and consumed large quantities of food and drink. Though their eyes were bigger than their stomachs, they presumed it a right and they craved for more. Nothing was ever big enough. Nothing could satisfy their ever-increasing appetite. The more they would receive, the more they wanted. They sought to please their own carnal pleasures as opposed to caring for their souls. They refused to hear Noah and see the physical evidence in which Noah was trying to let them know that if you don't get yourself right, you're going to fall in the flood. Just like today, despite preaching the gospel, despite hearing testimonies on how the Lord has been good, nothing seems to alter the behavior of this world. It is this illustration that Jesus teaches and reveals how when he returns, there will be recklessness and there will be unbelief. Just like the days of Noah, people will be enjoying the pleasures of life. They'll be enjoying life so much so that they will completely miss the signs and the warnings of God's judgment. While I believe that our generation has experienced more signs and warnings from God than any generation in history, I still see that the world is blind to the signs. I still see that the world doesn't see what God is doing. I still believe, after all that God is doing in the earth realm, that people don't want to believe that God is coming back and that God is going to judge our soul. See, many believe that this is the best of times. And that only the best is yet to come as it relates to the things that are in this world. But I'm reminded of the words of the Apostle Paul in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 3. For when he said peace and safety, then sudden destruction will come upon them as labor pains that comes upon a pregnant woman, and they shall not escape. In other words, up to the last moment, there will be people who will be ignorant of the judgment that's coming from our God. They'll be duped, they'll be stupid, they'll be dumb, they'll be foolish as it relates to the judgment that's waiting of this world. And I just stopped by to remind somebody that you have to understand, when the Lord comes, it will be sudden. When the Lord comes, it will be a surprise. When the Lord comes, what is expected, it will be unexpected. I'm through, y'all. I hope you learned something on today. I hope when you leave this place or you shut off your computer, you prepare yourself for the Lord. For the coming of the Lord is secret. The coming of the Lord will be sudden. But the last thing, before I raise up out of here, the last thing the Bible teaches us is that the coming of the Lord will bring separation. The Bible says two men will be in the field. One will be taken and the other left. Two women will be grinding at the meal. One will be taken and the other left. See, Jesus teaches us that a sudden coming will involve a separation. The interesting thing that Jesus illustrates in the Bible is that there will be two people involved in doing the same thing. There will be two people connected together. They may be working together. They may be engaged in the same event. They may be helping one another. They may even be related. They might be co-workers. They might be just good friends. And yet from the outside, when it appears to be that there's no difference between one man and another man. There's no difference between one woman and the other woman. From the naked eye, there's no indication that there's a difference between the two. They're both engaged in the work. They're both doing what's before them. But Jesus lets us know that while they may be engaged in the same thing, while they might be doing the same thing, there's going to be a separation when he returns. There's going to be a distinct difference made when he shows up. One will be taken and the other will be left. One will be at work and the other will be caught away and taken unto the Lord. One will be left in the task wondering where is the other, and the other won't be concerned about that labor anymore. Jesus brings us to the knowledge that while on the outside many may look the same, but on the inside there's something different. While on the outside there may be commonalities, but on the inside Jesus comes in the soul of a disciple, and that's what shouts our soul happy. That's what makes us rejoice, because of Christ in us, the hope of glory. This is what Paul says: finally, there's laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day.